current Czech society as analyzing its response to the ongoing refugee situation, if I may use the term, which is probably really better than refugee crisis. Why is the view of the majority of Czechs so much different or so much more radical, so much different from the approach of their German and Austrian fellow Europeans? What are Czechs afraid of and why? If one analyzes the debates on this topic, he or she will find out that not economic or generally material questions, but the struggle for identity is dominating the discourse. As a historian, I see here a deep connection to the character of the reconstruction of nation states in Central Eastern Europe after the Second World War. And I would like to elaborate this argument in the specific Czech context in my today's talk. First step of my argumentation I would call post-war cleansing. The popular image of the so-called Third Czechoslovak Republic behind 1945 and 1948, which pictures this era as a remarkable attempt to restore democracy, spiked by the communist coup d'état, doesn't make much sense in my opinion. The period between 1945 and 1948 belongs to the most bloody eras of Czech and Czechoslovak history, with 10,000 of dead people, with more than 3 million people deported of their homes, and with the deconstruction of basic principles of state rule. A high degree of state organized violence, as well as efforts to segregate different social groups, were practices that Czech society had experienced during the war and the occupation, of course. The immediate post-war plans for segregation and removal of alien elements and roots which go back at least to the war years. It was after the annexation in autumn 1938 and during the occupation when, in the discourse, the close link between ethnicity and reliability or unreliability had been developed and adopted by a considerable part of Czech society. With astonishing ease, these principles found their way into the inventory of the Czechs' own political and social practices and were largely considered normal by the authorities and ordinary citizens. The general Czech acceptance of the post-war expulsion of the Germans as being an equitable solution and the continuing acts of repression against the remaining Germans demonstrate just some of the ways that the Czechs in general were thinking and acting at the time. This approach was, however, used not only against the ethnic Germans, who were collectively identified as people who had caused the disintegration of Czechoslovakia and suffering experienced during the war. After the liberation, the society of the new nation state needed, according to most of its citizens, to be rid of all actual and potential threats. In addition to the ethnic Germans and the ethnic Hungarians in Slovakia, people of mixed ethnicity, Gypsies, German-speaking Jews, South Moravian Croats, and others were seen as alien and unreliable. And the political authorities as well as local agents soon turned to the logic of cleansing against other unreliable elements. Political practice of stigmatizing and segregating those participation in the building of society is perceived as undesirable, is generally considered an instrument of dictatorial rule. These dynamics, which may also be reasonably defined as social cleansing, did not, however, lose any of their momentum in post-war Czechoslovakia. This policy was in part formulated by the central authorities, security forces, and the elite of the political parties. At the same time, cleansing was intensified and conducted more radically in numerous activities and by numerous requests at the local level. This demand for ethnically clean and transparent society, articulated from below, was a characteristic feature of the second half of the 1940s, which impressed itself deeply in Czech society. In my second step, I will call the second argument, I would call the ethnicization of law. The development of plans for the expropriation and expulsion of the Germans from Czechoslovakia and the political practice of discriminating and marginalizing ethnic minorities in post-war Czechoslovakia can be interpreted as a consequence of the National Socialist concept of nationality and the reaction to the cruel reality of German occupation of Czech lands between 1938 and 1945. The Czechoslovak plans to ethnicize access to citizenship and to collectively depossess all members of certain national minorities that were developed between 1943 and 1945 by the government in exile in London, and that were turned into practice after May 1945, however, represent more than just a consequence and a reaction to the Nazi rule. This policy, in fact, adopted the main principles of discriminating or privileging people independence of their membership of an ethnic group. And in this sense, represents a continuity of principles realized from the National Socialist rule. The essential outlines of the ethnicization of civil rights by the presidential decrees after 1945 are, I think, well known. The limitation of citizenship and property rights by ethnicity, by language, and by cultural identity was a crucial principle of the reconstruction of Czechoslovakia in the second half of the 1940s. The construction of population groups with different rights depending on their ethnicity was slowly dismantled after the communist coup in the early 50s. The destruction of the former liberal principles of citizenship and property rights, regardless of country, identity or mother tongue, left, however, deep traces. Also, in the decades following, after the very period of post-war ethnic cleansing, the post-war legal and mental framework was not reversed, at least because of three aspects. The first aspect of this continuity of the post-war discourse in law. The granting of citizenship for all inhabitants and dismantling of ethnically defined limits in the legal framework, as realized in the first half of the 1950s, of course, did not stand for a return to the liberal state of law that would guarantee autonomy. The idea advocated by the internationalist communist elites that discrimination and segregation based on ethnicity cannot be tolerated in a communist state was never accepted by the broader society and even by local or regional functionaries of the communist party. And the very last argument concerning this topic, the property restitution after 1989 confirmed and ratified the linkage between property rights and ethnicity. Not property confiscation as such, but just confiscation of ethnic Czechs and Slovaks based on class criteria, which was realized after 1948, was now held for illegal and had to be revised. Also, the deprivation of citizenship based on ethnic criteria carried out after 1945 was now declared for a legitimate foundation of the restored democratic state. So summing up this argument or step in my argumentation, the legal construction of citizenship and property rights, as well as the process of redressing the injuries of the past, are both based on the bond between ethnicity and civil rights in Czech Republic after 1989. Czech Republic builds its historical legitimacy in that construction despite defining itself a liberal state of law. And coming to the third last step of my argumentation, which I called us and the others, a cultural homogeneity based identity. The Czechoslovak state was reconstructed as a national state in 1945, excluding minorities explicitly. these were identified as the crucial failures of the interwar Czechoslovakia, which led to the catastrophe of Munich. Czech political elites turned away from minority rights and the legal legal framework in their concepts of the future state organization as soon as at the end of 1938. During the war, this basic solution was only radicalized. The man who organized the settlement of the Czech borderlands after the ethnic Germans had been displaced from the region saw their task not just as solving the immediate demographic or economic problems. Resettling the borderlands was not understood as a matter of filling up an empty space. On the contrary, the borderlands were to be settled by moving best of the best, that is, nationally reliable, hardworking, and politically conscious people. A new society was meant to emerge there, healthier, more effective, and more just than any society in the history of Bohemian lands. The belief in the avant-garde role of the borderlands in post-war Czechoslovakia is reflected in these utopian ambitions. German society and German inhumanity were meant to be replaced by an ideal Slav community, characterized by German virtues characterized by Slavic virtues such as high level of discipline at work, but also solidarity and creativity, two most important virtues. Unity and reliability became central values of the project. In the effort to achieve homogeneity, removing the sources of conflict between old and new settlers seemed to be the communist approach towards nationalism was, of course, highly ambivalent and changed in time. We will find sharp nationalism as well as combative anti-nationalism or dogmatic internationalism among communist elites during the post-war decades. One thing, however, was common to all these approaches, I would say. It was rejecting any kind of autonomy of particular social groups. The people of a socialist state should not be divided through particular barriers or identities. Thus, we cannot have a state socialism in Czechoslovakia for an organized effort for ethnic or language homogeneity. We can, however, observe the maximum effort for cultural homogeneity during the whole communist dictatorship. This notion of somehow nebulously defined cultural homogeneity became remains a crucial value on which stands and falls the legitimacy of the Czech state. What does it mean in practice? All those who are ready to adapt and do not disturb are not necessarily perceived as a threat by the Vietnamese, Green Grocers, scattered Germans, or even Jews. Those who are not compatible, unfamiliar, or not ready to adapt and assimilate in the near future, however, are perceived as alien and potentially disturbed. In relation to these people, might it be Roma living in extremely poor conditions or people from different geographical and cultural backgrounds, the notion of a nation state owned by ethnic Czechs who only have the right to decide who belongs to the community and who doesn't revives periodically. Coming to my conclusion, the timing between civil rights and ethnic criteria and the broader idea of a cultural homogeneity, which was accepted and adopted by Czech society in connection with the post-war expulsion of German population, changed the identity of Czech society and built the basic legitimizing element of Czech state until our days. The domestic reaction to the latest development in the world and in Europe confirmed that the attempts to redefine the Czech self-perceptions towards a greater openness have not been successful yet. Policy making and society in Bohemian lands remains in the shadow of post-war ethnocracy, which justified the label that organized the displacement of German-speaking inhabitants. The originally sharply ethnic criteria were transferred into rather habitual notion of ordinary citizens. Nevertheless, particular categories of cultural belonging and adaptability are still more important than universal values such as global responsibility or solidarity with people in need. the shadow of the fortress in which we locked ourselves after the war by cleansing the country is terrible. Thank you.
Okay, so that's the thing. We will focus on one aspect of the current discourse and its role of political correctness in our nowadays public discourse on immigration. It's obvious that political correctness in this concept has been with us for some time, but we are used to it in other thematic domains other than the discourse of immigration, such as gender studies, most predominantly, I think, discussions about ethnicity, which is clearly related to immigration. But we now face an increase of because of the presence of the concept of political correctness in the very discourse on immigration and refugee situation in Europe now. And that's why we wanted to look at this pattern in more detail and see what happens there and what the pattern is about. Why we need to? You have examples like this in the media, Czech media. This is a commentary by Jan Leopold, which was posted Aktuálně.cz. And on the first sentence of the article, you can see that he speaks about successful rejection of political correctness, which leads to another phase, it's a process that leads to another phase, a new phase, and which is an open hatred. And this is a very interesting quote, actually, because the rejection of political correctness, the political correctness of the concept, is in the subject position, it's in the topical sequence of the sentence, and so it's presupposed that the readers of this article have already heard about the concept, that it's present in the discourse, and that we as readers, as recipients of this information, are aware of what's going on here. That's the first point I want to make here. Then he claims that the rejection of political correctness is a process that's successful, and it's somehow in contrast with what's the new phase of the process, the open hatred. So it's a scalar process that has distinct phases, and now we arrive at a new phase, which is an open hatred. So there is a contrast between something that's successful is usually perceived as beneficial, and now we have something that's negative and it's open-hated. That's another point that was interesting for us, and therefore we decided to dig into it in more detail. So what are our questions? For this talk, we will focus predominantly on the first one. What does happen when we attack as actors in the discourse on immigration? What happens when we attack the political correctness? Is it a sort of legitimization strategy in the discourse of refugees and national identity? You will see that there is a predominant negative evaluation of the fact of being politically correct. Most of this discourse, I just say, it's a negative concept and negative social behavior. And this allows the actors to evaluate positively extreme statements because they are open, they express their opinions openly, they refuse to be politically correct, and therefore it's positive behavior in the discourse. And thus, it may be so that the extremist positions are legitimized and justified in the current Czech public discourse. So, is this argumentation valid? Is this really happening in the discourse? There's another aspect of this question. It is whether the fact of the political correctness itself is or is not an issue for critical discourse analysis. Is it threatening the cause and basic fundamental aims of the critical discourse analysis, or is it not? As usual, you know, the key aim of the CDA approach is to identify asymmetries in social relations and to analyze how they are produced or reproduced in the discourse. There's an obvious commitment within CDA, and which is to contribute to eliminating these asymmetries by analyzing the discourse. So, what is it about the political correctness? What comes with political correctness and its refusion? Is it formally anti-discriminatory discourse practice, but conceptually the discrimination is still there underpinning the discourse? And is it really so that changing the way we talk, as presupposed by the CDA, truly changes the way we behave and think, or is it just the negative effect of political correctness that we formally change what we say, we change the words, but nevertheless the social reality remains the same, and therefore it turns out that seeking approach is unsuccessful. It's very basics. So this is a crucial question, more or less theoretical. We work, Michal and I, we work within the discourse historical approach that Ruth presented shortly in the morning. I'll just mention a few terms that we will use throughout our analysis. DHA distinguishes between macroanalysis, which is usually an analysis of large corpus of texts upon which you generalize patterns, as Alana did with metaphor patterns in media. And you usually combine it with the microanalysis of particular texts. You presuppose that there are always ideologically underpinned positions present in the discourse, and you want to show what discursive strategies are used and what linguistic means are used in order to produce these ideologies. The common set of strategies expected by DHA in any discourse is strategies such as how we label things, how we categorize them as denomination, what events and properties we attribute to them as predications, what argumentation we use, how we build a coherent position in the discourse, and how we which expressive means, either hyperbolizing or mitigating, we use in order to construct aspects of them. That's what we heard in previous talks here. I will use a very typical term for the DHA, which is the topos. We mentioned that in the morning. And it is a complex pattern that makes argumentation to conclusions in the discourse, and as we heard before, it is a shortcut. It doesn't uncover all the steps in argumentation. It can be both reasonable and fallacious, depending on how it is used. And what's important about it is that it's conventionalized and it's recurring in the discourse. You can call a topos something that's really recurring in your data. Just to give you an example, I put here an example from one text, whose author is Pascal Claus, and it's actually from one work written by Ruth herself, which focused on Claus's discourse on global environment issues. And it's typical for him to introduce a topos of realism in in his talks and everything basically. It's a great favorite to us of his. And as you can see, he wants usually to realistically evaluate something. We have to reflect that it is obvious, that it is evident that nothing of this can be made. You have to be realistic, you have to evaluate what you can do as a politician, what you can't, what you can change, what you can't. So he just thinks that naturally occurring processes in nature, in this discourse environment, cannot be changed by any politician, by any decision, because it's just happening and you don't have access to this domain. So this, that was realism in his talks. So what we did actually, we have we did one macro analysis. We pick up monitoring of TV media between 1st and 30th September 2015. There were newspapers, broadcasting, and TV included. We searched for the words like correctness, correct, correctly, politically correct, politically correctly. And we had 594 texts, but we left out irrelevant instances, and such as soccer team plays rough but correct, and duplicities, which let us arrive at 164 texts were political correctness, politically correct, and politically correctly, where these phrases were used in the sense that we wanted to analyze with respect to the discourse of migration and refugee situation. So then we looked up at standard aspects of how this phrase is used. For instance, we evaluated the context and searched for how political correctness as a concept is evaluated in the discourse. And unsurprisingly, out of all 164 instances, only 4 were positive. Positively evaluated the politically correct behavior of anyone. And also, unsurprisingly, one of these 4 instances, 4 occurrences, were made by Shimon Panek, the director of Cholifiki's non-government organization that helps refugees in Syria and Iraq. 26 were neutral or more or less. They were not explicitly negative, so there were no clue terms, no implication domain or nomination. There were no words that are negative in nature, and whereas in the third subset with 130 examples, explicit negative evaluation of the political correctness was made. And there was a strong correlation with the refugee situation. Then we analyzed data for syntactic functions, so in which syntactic position you can find the political correctness. We left out adjectives and verbs, and first had a look at subject position and then at the object position. So that's what you will see in this slide and on the following slide. Out of subject positions that we found in the data, usually political correctness is attributed a certain quality, such as political correctness means lying. Political correctness is a victory of Brussels or something. Secondly, political correctness was perceived as an actor in itself. So political correctness has created something like Simon. Political correctness causes a loss of freedom to us and stuff like that. So it's personalized as an actor, or it's evident that there's some human actor behind it, but linguistically it is presented as an actor itself. So the graph is just repeating what words there. As for the object position, political correctness is usually an instrument, or post-verbal position. Political correctness is an instrument. Political correctness can be misused as a tool. We can commit, Europeans can commit suicide with using political correctness. Another set of examples includes ideological position in construing political correctness. We worship political correctness. There's an explicit censorship due to political correctness and the discourse and stuff like that. And the third conceptualization is presenting the political correctness as a game. We play with the political correctness. We play a European game of political correctness. So there's an aspect of chance, of non-control, losing control over it, and playing with it. It's something that's very serious. So last two slides about what we discovered. The agents behind the political correctness are mostly external. It's not the group of us. We are not construed as agents of the political correctness, the readers of direct people's government, the active agents in the discourse. It's usually the European Union, America, which imposes the political correctness on us, or allies in the society which do not have a direct contact with reality. Allies lose the contact with what happens really in the outside world, and therefore they are still be politically correct. The agent is predominantly someone that's external. Where political correctness is a subject and actor, there happens that personification. I mentioned it a while ago. The last thing we did, we looked at nominations and predications that are common with the political correctness in the whole data set. We had synonyms to political correctness are either lying, elitism, or concession, which oppose to its antonyms, such as seeking the truth, the ability to name the problems we have. So that's one link between synonymy and antonymy in this domain. Another is that political correctness can be presented as a dictate, as a censorship, which is opposed to our right of expressing ourselves, freedom of expression, our right and capacity to invent new labels, new names, new designations. There's the evaluation that political correctness is pretty stable in the world, and it is opposed to our everyday casual language, which is more real than political correct language, evidently. And then there are verbs associated to the political correctness, and political correctness either strengthens, creates, or leads to something that's negative, which because it's a danger or it's a lie, or it can reject, refuse, and provide something that's positive and it may be truth. Okay, so there's a clear conflict between these conceptualizations. So what we can see in our data and in the meta-analysis is that political correctness restricts language. It's shared by all discourse actors in the data we have. There are you can either present it as expressive means, which are restricted, so just don't use the word refugee because it's politically correct, that's what Orbán says in Hungary. Or you can conceive it as a sign with both formal and symbolic part or conceptual part. And so political correctness restricts you from saying what you really think, you know? You change words and this limits the ways of representing real things with right words. It can be an instrument, it can be a dictate, and it's interesting that it changes the fact of having politically correct statements and refusing them, changes the concept and meaning of a word of a process of discussion. Discussion is not presenting your views anymore, it's an ever-ending process of attributing labels to entities. That's what discussion means in this this discourse of political correctness. Another claim you can make on data is that to challenge the political correctness means to construe oneself as a minority. So that's a very clear strategy you can see there. You say this is politically correct, I want to refuse it. And by saying this, I'm a minority because political correctness is should be a major strategy imposed on us. And you want to fight a superior, therefore you are brave enough when you come into this course as a minority to try to change it. And there's a clear strategy that by refusing political correctness, you want to get a control over the discourse. So you say political correctness is controlling us constantly, there's constant control of what we are and what we think by the dictate of the political correctness. I want to refuse it, and that's what is not added. I want to control the discourse myself. No? So by appealing to the political correctness, you get to control it, the discourse, the discourse yourself. That's how to do it, how to get it. And in a few minutes, I think I have 5 minutes or so, I'll just show you the microanalysis we did afterwards, which focused on the concerts organized by Daniel Landa in September. That's why we searched for the topos of political correctness in the discourse in this period, just to correlate it with the discourse on Landa's concert. I won't go into detail about who Daniel Landa and Orlik is, I'm sure you know about this. What's interesting, we took a bunch of texts that commented on the concert. There were not many reviews, the proper gender reviews of the concert. There were much more commentaries that said almost nothing about the concert and commented on political and public perspective related to Landa and this great concert. So proper context was introduced. And interestingly, all these articles about Landa's concert share not only a topic, but certain modules that you have short or simple map on the right side of the slide. So everybody commented on how Landa changes his public identity from time to time, from a temper to a high priest, provocateur, or a mage, or a magician, and stuff like that. That he has a polarized image. It's interesting. Landa's image, public image, is it's not a scale, it's just two extreme points. Either you hate him or you love him, nothing in between. Landa himself, and also the discourse of Landa, comments on how his access to public discourse is restricted. He says that he's usually misinterpreted by journalists and by public discourse, and therefore he has to fight for being understood, fight for being presented. His words taken care of in order to be presented as he said them. Another point made by all comments is that you can or you cannot interpret music, his music or music in general, in social and cultural context. There are such terms as that Landes concern was a typical sign for our times, or that it reintroduced some concepts that were pushed away from the public discourse and stuff like that. And there's a strong topos of history, both Landes' individual history linked to the Pat Holly, and also as well to the communist era before 1989 and the censorship of the time. And we ask the question how and why PC is a political economist is present in this context. There's an opposing, there are two competing positions in two comments made by Andrzej Bezer and Spachilova, which both write articles for Ines Cezek. Bezer was shocked in his comment, he was shocked by the fact that Landa sang two songs by Orly at his concert, and he very strongly based his comment on the topos of history, topos of common knowledge, topos of shared knowledge of how to how that certain things have to be avoided once you've grown up and you are not young anymore. So you can sometimes you can do something out of as a sin of your youth, but once you get older and you cross the border of being adult, you cannot do that anymore. It's illegitimate. And Mirka Spachilova commented on this in the respect that we have another dictate of political correctness by refusing the fact that Landa could sing these songs, and that this is very similar to vetting strategies that were present in the past, in our past. And actually, this was interesting also for this discussion. My discussion was interesting because Bezer's article, which tried to put Orlik's texts and songs again out of the order of the public discourse, received 1,382 comments below the article, which all tried to explain that Landa should be allowed to sing these songs. And whereas Mirka Spachilova's text received 49 comments, which were of this kind. Either they applauded to Spachilova for having written such a text, or they were expressed happiness to have one Landa and not 1,000 multiculturalists. And some of them commented on the fact that almost no reviews were written in the public discourse or on the concert, but only these general comments addressing this political correctness stuff and broader context. So this is the discussion below the article written by Spachilova. Actually, Bezer and Spachilova are part of a broader intertextual thread where Karel Veselý and Kamil Fila tried to defend the political correctness. And these texts, I won't go into details, but these texts are interesting because they are the only ones that try to build a positive image of the strategy of being politically correct in a public discourse. You cannot find others, and there's not a clear narrative that tries to be to defend political correctness as a positive phenomenon, as a part of political culture. So there's a specific situation, usually in competing narratives in a discourse, any discourse on any topic. You have competing narratives, two dominant narratives that compete. It's not the case here. Both the macroanalysis and the microanalysis discover that what we have is just one concept of one dominant concept of the political correctness, which is reemerging and recontextualizing discursive pattern. It is negative negative political correctness rule. There are external agents that are to blame. You have to reject the political correctness because you want to label entities with their proper names, which is a phrase that's very common in this discourse, which allows you to free yourself from a control and which you don't stay, assume explicitly you want to establish your own control over the discourse. There's a strong analogy with other discourses, such as a discourse analyzed by Joe Angeri and Ruth Woodard in 2014 on Greece, and on the rise of the Golden Dawn party. So it is really, indeed, it is a sort of justification strategy of legitimation strategy of the extremist discourse perspective. And it's true that this negative political construe is reflected in the discourse, but it's not replaced by an alternate universe, by an alternate narrative. Nothing of that is present. Actually, the text by Karel Veselý is very interesting in this respect, because he says it's already a little bit tiring to keep explaining that political correctness may be positive. So there is a certain, either you predict that at least some people know about the artificiality of this political correctness construal, and you don't go into detail of explaining it because you've done that for years or so. And so there's a tiresome attitude on the side of those who want to defend the positive political correctness construal. So there's nothing to compete with the negative picture of the political correctness, and which is very specific about the discourse. And that actually might be the role for political discourse analysis, because it has tools how to uncover these strategies, how to show that the political correctness construal is a pattern. It's not a genuine situation. It really re-emerges, it's predictable, you can say that it's been cut out from another discourse and planted in another in order to control the discourse. And so it can help you actually to construe another narrative on the basis of reflecting what the opposing narrative is about.
Thank you and enjoy that.